portions that you have to cover with respect to drying. So the major topics that you have to study with respect to drying, the concepts that you should be clear about is regarding, first of all, moisture content. The basics of moisture content with regard to dry basis moisture content, wet basis moisture content, the amount of water evaporated. Mostly the students make wrong mistakes while calculating the water evaporation numericals, because they don't have a good base regarding the moisture content. So first of all, we should be clear regarding moisture content with respect to dry basis, wet basis. And with respect to moisture content, dry basis and wet basis, there are many equations like conversion from dry basis to wet basis for moisture evaporation. Rather than studying the equations, rather than mugging up the equations, you should be clear regarding the concepts. What does that mean? So why moisture content is expressed in dry basis? So what is the importance of expressing it in dry basis when we can simply express it in wet basis? So that that is regarding the drying rate curve. So that portion should be clear. Then water activity. See, why we do dry? In food, we do drying as a part of preservation method. So what happens? How the food get preserved? Like in freezing, the food get preserved by reducing the water activity as well as reducing the reactions, enzymatic reactions or microbial reactions. But in drying, it only happens by reducing the water activity. So what is water activity? What is the, how it differs from moisture content? There are some equations regarding water activity. There are many equations regarding water activity, like for porous food, for ideal solutions, for non-ideal solutions. So that concept should be clear. Then drying rate curve. The drying rate curve, mostly the constant drying rate curve. It should be well clear, the concept of the drying rate regarding constant rate period should be clear. The moisture ratio calculations. Then another important thing is Henderson equations. While going through the previous year question paper, especially for agriculture engineering stream, we can see many numericals coming from Henderson equation. So Henderson equation is an important aspect, like ERH, equilibrium relative humidity calculation. Then the principles behind each dryer. There are many dryers. So what is the basic principle? Like in freeze dry, the basic principle is the sublimation. The saturation curve, it should be clear. So what is triple bond, it should be clear. So based on that, the concept should be clear. Then heat and mass transfer equations, especially heat transfer equations. Because with regard to food process engineering or numericals regarding food process engineering, the heat transfer equations or heat transfer concept should be clear. Because only there are only two equations, Q is equal to MC by delta T, Q is equal to UA delta T. So what is Q is equal to MC by delta T? What is Q is equal to UA delta T? So Q is equal to MC by delta T is regarding a single fluid, the heat transfer occurring in a single medium. But Q is equal to UA delta T, that Q is regarding the transfer of heat between two mediums. That concept should be clear. Okay, then basically you should be well clear of the dimensions, the units, because many numericals, even if you don't know the equations, we can solve it by just dimensional analysis, by just looking into the units, we can expect what is the equation. Because in food process engineering numericals, even though we don't know the equations or we don't know how to solve a numerical, by looking into the units, we can formulate an equation, or we can express an equation. Because in land and water engineering, we can't do that like this, because there are some coefficients for CD, that coefficient, or that depends on the shapes. But here, the case is that mostly we can directly make an equation, or we can just remember the equation by looking into the units. That we'll see when we go through the numerical sessions. So basically, these portions, there are a lot more portions regarding drying, but basically these portions should be, the concepts regarding these portions should be well clear to the aspirants. Okay, I hope this slide is clear to you. Okay, any doubts? Okay, then okay. So next we will, since we have only 1 hour session, we will go through some numericals in the previous year GATE exam questions and how it is solved and what are the basic mistakes, what are the common mistakes that students make while solving. We will look into that. So first question we will discuss, you can see in the screen, a batch of 100 kilogram of grain at 32% moisture content in wet basis is being dried using hot air at 70 degrees Celsius and 30% RH. The values of Henry's equation constants C and N for the grain are 8.5 Newton ratio minus 6, 2.07 respectively. Consider maximum possible drying of the batch, the quantity of moisture removed in kilogram. Okay, so this numerical is solved with respect to Henry's equation. Do you know the Henry's equation? Anybody? Henry's equation regarding equilibrium relative humidity or equilibrium moisture content. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So try to make it an interactive session rather than just a lecture. Okay. So for Henderson equation, that is 1 minus RH is equal to E raised to minus CT M raised to N. And minus RH is equal to E raised to minus CT M raised to N. RH is relative humidity, C and N are constants, M is the equilibrium moisture content. Okay, so basically the C and N value will be given, the RH value will be given. Here, the question is asking about what is the moisture content, because we have to calculate the amount of water evaporated. So for calculating the amount of water evaporated, we should know the moisture content at the 2 points, before drying and after drying. So basically, the majority of students make mistakes. What are the mistakes that commonly we see is here, RH value should be put in decimal because always 1 minus RH. 1 minus RH means RH value is given in percentage, then it should be put in decimal. That is here 0.3. Then E raised to minus. Many students forget to put the minus. Minus C value will be given T, temperature. Temperature should be in Kelvin. Okay, these are the major mistakes. So RH should be in decimal, T value should be in Kelvin, then moisture content. The moisture content that we get is in dry basis, not in wet basis. So these three key points should be well clear with regard to Henry's equation. Normally students, what they would do, they just mug up the equation, 1 minus RH, E raised to minus CT, M raised to N, okay, RH, ME, okay, okay. But when they do the numericals, they get confused. Okay, should I put RH in decimal? Should I put in Kelvin, temperature in Kelvin? Is the moisture content that we get is in wet basis? So these three points should be well aware. So regarding that, we are solving the equations. As you can see in the screen, 1 minus 0.3 into E raised to minus. Then by taking the natural logarithm, we get 122.33 is equal to M raised to 2.07. Then by taking the either you can take log, either or you can take the ratio integral exponential. That is 2.33 raised to 1/2.07. So from that we will get moisture content in 10.2. That the moisture content is in dry basis. So from that, either this can be done in different ways. Either we can convert that moisture content in dry basis into wet basis, then take the difference, or we can approach in the given way. Like we know the initial moisture content is 32%. So dry matter is, since it is 100 kilogram, total dry matter is 68 kilogram. Okay, so the 68 kilogram has W amount of water after dry. So what will be W? Because W by 60, amount of water by amount of dry matter is equal to moisture content in dry basis. So W by 68, because in drying, the dry matter doesn't changes before drying and after drying. The dry matter doesn't change. So based on that anchor point, we do the solution. We solve the numerator. So here, the 68 kilogram dry matter remains same. So the final moisture content is 10.2% in dry basis. That means the amount of water by amount of dry matter into 100 is equal to 10.2. The final amount of water we take here as W. The dry matter we know it is 68 kilogram. Is equal to 10.2 by 100. That is 0.102. From that we get W is equal to 6.93. That is the amount of water, final amount of water present in the dried food material. That is 6.93 kilogram. So what is the initial amount of water present? It is 32 kilogram. Since it is 100 kilogram, 32% moisture content in wet basis shows that it contains 32 kilogram of water. So 32 minus 6.93, we get 25.07. Our answer is D. Okay. So important things to remember is RH is in decimal, T is in Kelvin, the M, the moisture content that we get from the Henderson equation is in dry basis. Okay. So next is also a similar kind of questions. Here C and N values given. Moisture content is given. Moisture content has to be calculated. RH value is given. Temperature is given. So similarly, as we done in the previous problem, similarly, you can solve the equation and we get the answer by 26 to 30. That means we get the answer about 28. So next question. Next question is match the following question. It's a simple question. So there is a different approaches. There are different strategies to find the solution. Sometimes we can find the correct answer from the options given. Okay, because sometimes we may not know the complete answer. If for column 1, 4 data are given, column 2, 4 data are given, maybe we know only two datas, the match. By looking into the options, we can just eliminate whatever the wrong options and we can conclude a single option. So always you go through different approaches. Ultimately, the objective of exam is to find the solution, whatever method you use. So here, for example, if we know the freeze dryer, it is sublimation. Rest we don't know. So we can see the three matches with Q. The options that comes will be C and B, where three matches with Q. Then we just think spray dryer two. So spray dryer matches with a cyclone separator. So we can ultimately point out the answer as B. So I have given this numerical as an example how to approach from a solution or the options given to find the right solution. Okay. These are all previous questions. Okay. I hope up to this it will be clear. It is clear. I think only 10 students are there. You can interact. Otherwise, there is no use of such kind of sessions. Okay. Okay. Okay, so the next question, you can read from the screen. In a drying experiment, the constant rate of drying is found to be 3.6 kilogram water per meter square per hour, dry bulb and wet bulb temperature 75 and 37 degrees Celsius. A latent heat of vaporization at dry bulb and wet bulb temperature are 2321 and 2414 kilojoule per kilogram respectively. the convective heat transfer coefficient has to be found. Okay, so here the question is to find convective heat transfer coefficient. So earlier I mentioned from the units we can conclude to an equation, or we can make a strategy to solve the numerical. So here the question asked is convective heat transfer coefficient. Here the equation that we use is Q is equal to HA into TA minus TS. Q is the heat transfer, H is the heat transfer coefficient, A is the area of heat transfer, TA and TS is the, TA is the temperature of the air, TS is the surface temperature of the food. So this is the equation. But suppose we may not know the equation, or we have some misconceptions, or we have some doubt regarding the equations, then just go through the units. What we have to find is watt per meter square per Kelvin. What given is kilojoule per kilogram is given. Kilogram water per meter square per hour is given. Kelvin temperature is given. So by multiplying this watt per meter square Kelvin, how can we get watt per meter square Kelvin? If we multiply the kilojoule per kilogram into kilogram per meter square per hour, what we get is watt per meter square. Then we divide it by temperature, we get Kelvin. So this is the basic strategy if you don't know the equation. So here we use the equation Q is equal to HA into TA minus TS, where Q by A is equal to latent heat into evaporation rate per unit area. Okay, here latent heat is given. The two latent heats are given. So what we use the latent heat is 2414. Why? Because it is the product temperature. The product, the water is evaporating from the product. So here we use the latent heat 2414 kilojoule per kilogram. Evaporation rate per unit area is given 3.6 kilogram water per meter square per hour. So here we have to convert hour to seconds. Hour to second by 60 into 60 divided by. Then also many students, based on my experience, many students make the mistakes while using kilojoule. They forget to put the value 10^3. So always remember, when you use kilojoule, you use 10^3, or else you get the value or the answer in kilowatt. It is better to put 10^3 there to avoid the mistakes. So by taking the latent heat 2414 from the equations, we have to find its heat transfer coefficient, convective heat transfer coefficient. Here TS is the surface temperature, but we don't have the surface temperature. Actually, the given temperature is wet bulb temperature. So what is wet bulb temperature? The wet bulb temperature, we know the wet bulb temperature. I hope you have studied the wet bulb temperature. In the wet bulb, by measuring the wet bulb temperature, we put a wet cloth or wet cotton on the bulb of the thermometer and we measure the temperature. So always wet bulb temperature will be less than the dry bulb temperature because the water gets evaporated from the wet cloth. So similarly, the food surface temperature. So we can equate the food surface temperature as the wet bulb temperature of the air. So that is why we have taken TS, the surface temperature food, as the wet bulb temperature. So the values are given. We have to find H. We have Q by A, TA minus TS. Q by A, we can calculate by multiplying latent heat into evaporation rate per unit area. Latent heat is 2414 into 10^3 into 3.6 by hour. Hour, we convert over to second. 3600 into, that is divided by the temperature difference, 75 minus 37. Also, by solving the process engineering or food processing numericals, you check the temperature, the units, it is given in Kelvin. So we should convert the temperature to Kelvin. But here we directly putting the degree Celsius temperature, 75 and 37. Why? We are not converting to Kelvin because always the temperature change. For regarding temperature change, we no need to have to convert to Kelvin because even if we convert it to Kelvin, we add 273 on both sides. So we get the temperature difference are the same as degree Celsius temperature difference. Other than that, whenever you comes to a temperature data in equation, if it comes alone, you have to check, you have to cross verify whether it is in degree Celsius or wet it is in Kelvin. If it is in Kelvin, other equations are given in Kelvin, you should convert it to Kelvin. If delta T is coming, temperature difference is coming, you don't need to convert it to Kelvin because the temperature difference will be same even if it is converted or not converted. So here we, by substituting the data as given, we get the solution 63.5 watt per meter square Kelvin. That is the heat transfer coefficient. So basically, for heat transfer, we use two equations, Q is equal to MC by delta T, Q is equal to UA delta T. This should be well aware, Q is equal to MC by delta T and Q is equal to UA delta T. In Q is equal to MC by delta T, it is regarding a single fluid. For example, we are heating milk in a heat exchanger, using a hot water. The temperature of the milk rises, the temperature of the hot water reduces. So the temperature, the heat transfer within the milk, that we can calculate if we know the temperature difference between the initial temperature of the milk and the final temperature of the milk by using Q is equal to mCp delta T. M is the mass flow rate of milk, Cp will be the specific capacity of the milk, delta T will be the temperature difference of the milk, initial and final. Similarly, the hot water temperature reduces, its Cp value, its M value, its delta value, you can get Q. But here, a heat transfer is occurring between the fluids, hot water and the milk. That Q is the Q is equal to UA delta T. I hope you understand. That Q we calculate by using U, overall heat transfer coefficient for the heat exchanger. A is the area of heat transfer and delta T. Here delta T, Q is equal to UA delta T, delta T is the temperature difference between the fluids. But the temperature difference sometimes may not be the arithmetic mean, because always it should be, for example, you are taking counter current, the temperature difference at different time interval will be different, vary. So that is why we take logarithmic mean of the temperature difference, that is LMTD. I hope you have heard of LMTD, logarithmic mean temperature difference. So for other also, because majority of the preservation process or thermal process are of heat and mass transfer nature, and in most heat transfer process, the basic equations are these two equations. By knowing these two equations very well, you can solve majority of the numericals regarding heat transfer. So you should be well aware of that equation. Okay. The next question. In a tray drying under adiabatic process, hot air enters the dryer at 50 degrees Celsius bulb temperature and 100% RS with enthalpy of 70.2 kilojoule per kilogram of dryer. The air leaving the dryer gains 20% moisture. Considering the saturated water vapor pressure as 12.349 kilopascal at 50 degrees Celsius bulb temperature, the enthalpy of the air leaving the dryer in kilojoule per kilogram of dryer. So first of all, when we look into the question, it appears to be a very complex problem, but it is a simple problem because the term adiabatic process, I hope you studied about psychrometric chart. In a psychrometric chart, there are different processes that you plot, drying process, humidification, dehumidification. So adiabatic process, or in adiabatic process, the process goes through a path of same enthalpy. The enthalpy doesn't change. So here it is given the drying is in adiabatic process. So in adiabatic process, there is no heat loss or gain. The sensible heat lost by the air is converted to the latent heat in the added water. So there will be no enthalpy change per kilogram of dry air. Okay, so here the enthalpy is given as, initial enthalpy is given as 70.2 kilojoule per kilogram of dry air. Since it is an adiabatic process, the enthalpy will be same, 70.2 kilojoule per kilogram of dry air. Okay. So next question regarding drying, you can see, is with respect to moisture content. M kilogram of wheat at 9.8% moisture content in wet basis is a condition for 6 hours in 75 kilogram of water. A sample of 25 gram condition which is crushed and dried in hot air oven at 130 degrees Celsius for 1 hour that yields 20.5 gram of bone dried material. What is the value of that? That is, what is the value of initial value or initial weight of wheat? So initial moisture content is given, the amount of water added is given, then final moisture content in dry base is given. Okay, so as I said earlier, during drying, the dry matter doesn't change. The dry matter remains constant. So what is the total dry matter for the wheat in the initial condition? So total weight is M. So 9.8% moisture content is given in wet basis. So if you take 100 kilogram, 9.8 kilogram will be water and 90.2 kilogram will be dry matter. So here the total dry matter, if you take M kilogram of it, the total dry matter will be M into 90.2%. 90.2 by 100, that is 0.902. Okay, keep it there. What is the final mass of the product? So always we can substitute by proportionality. For example, you know, in the final condition, we take 20.5 gram of dry matter if we take a sample of 25 gram. So for 20.5 gram of dry matter, we get 20.5 gram of dry matter, we get 25 gram of total weight. Okay, because the ratio will be 20.5 and 10.5. Okay, so 20.5 gram dry matter we get from 25 grams. So from that, the final mass will be multiplied with M into 0.902, because 20.5 is dry matter. So 20.5 dry matter, we need 25 gram of total mass. For our case, the dry matter is M into 0.902. So that will be the final mass. This final mass is equal to M plus 75, the water amount of water already added. So by equating the equation, M plus 75 is equal to M into 0.902 into 20.5. We get the value M as 750 kilogram. Okay, so the numericals similar to these numericals, we can solve by different methods. If the concept is clear, you can solve by the concept. If you know the equation, that is depends upon your strength and your weakness. If you are going through a concept-oriented approach, you will get an accurate or a precise result. You will be sure that result is correct. But it will take some time. If you are going through equations, like solving, there are many equations already there. If you go solve using the equations already used, you may doubt the answer is correct or not if you have a doubt in the equation. So based on your strength and based on your weakness, you decide the approach. It's better, I suggest, even if it takes time, you go through conceptual approach by solving many numericals. You can solve the same numerical within a short span of time by applying the concept. Okay, so I hope it is very clear. It is based on the concept that the dry matter remains same. So that we calculate the initial dry matter, M into 0.902. Based on the final dry matter, we calculate the final dry mass. We get in the total mass, that is M plus 75. From that, we get the M value, that is 750 kilograms. Okay. Okay. Is there any doubt regarding this numerical, the previous numerical? Okay, so the next numerical, a rotary dryer is used to dry 1200 kilogram per hour of paddy containing 30% moisture content in wet basis to give a product containing 15% moisture content in wet basis. Alternately, a portion of the dry product may be recycled and mixed with the fresh feed such that the mixed feed enters the dryer with the moisture content of 20% wet basis. The moisture evaporation rate without recycle and the paddy recycle rate. Okay, the question is regarding a rotary dryer. So the feeding rate is 1200 kilogram per hour. Initial moisture content of the feeded paddy is 30%, that is in wet basis. the final moisture content of the dried paddy is 15%. Okay. So here, in the next step, some portion of the dried paddy is mixed with the feed. We don't know what portion is mixed, but after mixing, a certain amount of paddy is mixed with the feed. After mixing, the product obtained in the outer dryer is 20% moisture content in wet basis. That is the question. So first, we have to calculate the moisture evaporation rate. How much water is evaporated without recycling? That is the normal condition. That is 1,200 kilogram per hour of paddy from 30% moisture content is reduced to 15% moisture content. Okay, so normally the preliminary stage, the students make find the difference 30 minus 15, so 15% is reduced. So this approach will not work. So we have to calculate the initial amount of water. The initial amount of water, we know it is 30% moisture content. So for 1,200 kilogram, it contains 30 kilogram water. For 1,200, it contains 360 kilogram water. So dry matter will be 1,200 minus 360 or 1,200 into 0.7. That is 70%. That is 840 kilograms. So initial values are found. Then the 15% moisture content is given in wet basis. So either we can convert it into dry basis, or we can substitute the the equation amount of water by amount of dry matter. By that we can convert. Either any approach we can use. Here I used the dry basis moisture content is converted to wet basis. That is, the dry basis moisture content we can convert wet basis using equation moisture content in wet basis by 1 minus moisture content in wet basis. So 15% moisture content in wet basis when converted to dry basis, we get 17.65% moisture content. So always keep in mind the dry basis moisture content will always be a greater value than the wet basis moisture content. Here dry basis moisture content is 70.65, moisture content wet basis is 50. So while doing the numerical, if you get a dry basis moisture content value less than the wet basis moisture content when you convert, you suddenly decide that you are doing it wrong. Because always the moisture content in dry basis will be greater than the moisture content in wet basis, and the moisture content in dry basis value can be greater than 100%. Only the students get a doubt because the moisture content x percentage should be maximum value 100, but when we calculate the dry basis, sometimes it get more than 100. So they doubt whether they are doing right. So the dry basis moisture content value is possible to. Here the dry basis moisture content value greater than 100. Because if we take 50% moisture content in wet basis, the value when we convert to dry basis, we get 100%. So for moisture content above 50% in wet basis, the value will be more than 100. Okay, so here we convert it to dry basis. Okay, so similar to the previous problem, here for 100 kilogram of dry matter, I get 17.65 kilogram of water. For 100 kilogram of dry matter, contains 17.65 kilogram of water vapor. So for 840 kilogram, it contains 148.24 kilogram. Okay, that is for 100 gram or 100 kilogram, it contains 17.65 kilogram of water. So for 840, it contains 148.24. So this 148.24 is the final water content, total amount of water present in the food after dry. So what is the water evaporated? The initial amount of water, total water is 360. The final total amount of water is 148.2. By taking the difference, we get the value 211.7. So we get half of the numerical solved. So the answer will be either A or B. Okay. So next it is asked the paddy recycle rate. The paddy recycle rate we can calculate by the following method. So we are doing the mass balance, that is the amount of water. Okay, so when we put 30% moisture content, 1,200 kilogram plus, we are recycling, or we are putting in another amount, P value, P amount of dried paddy. So the amount of water will be P into 0.15. So total will be 1200 plus P into 0.2. The final revenue is 20% more than that. So by equating the equation, we get the P value as 2400 kilograms per hour by doing the mass balance. So the answer will be answer A, 211.6 and 2400. Okay. So the next problem is the specific heat capacity of dry air and water vapor are 1.005 and 1.88 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin respectively. So in an energy conserving system, 1 kilogram per second of air at 30 degrees Celsius with constant absolute humidity of 0.02 kilogram of water per kilogram of dry air is heated up to 65 degrees Celsius. Water at the wet bulb temperature of air is then sprayed into the air so that the final temperature of the air-water vapor mixture is 40 degrees Celsius. Latent heat of vaporization of water 70 degrees Celsius and 40 degrees Celsius are 2334 and 2407 kilojoule per kilogram. So, regarding humidity, we express humidity by using two terms, latent humidity and absolute humidity. So, absolute humidity is the absolute value, that is the amount of water vapor present per kilogram of dry air. That is the similar way of we express moisture content in dry basis. So it is a ratio. Absolute humidity is a ratio. Amount of water vapor present per kilogram of dry air. Relative humidity is different. Relative humidity is the amount of water vapor present by total, what it can hold, what the air can hold the amount. If it is 100%, it means the air is holding the 100% of its capacity. That is why by increasing the moisture content or increasing the humidity after RS, it starts to precipitate, it starts to dew point because the air is carrying its maximum capacity. So the absolute humidity and relative humidity. So even if the relative humidity remains same, the absolute humidity value may change. Okay, that is even if the absolute humidity remains same, the relative humidity can change, because if you look into the psychrometric chart, the relative humidity curve goes and the absolute humidity is horizontal line from the right. So for a constant absolute humidity line, when we go from our right to left for a constant absolute humidity line, the relative humidity value increases. Okay. But if we take a constant RS value, the absolute humidity goes from the bottom to top. The value changes. So that we should be clear, because many times the students get confused. Sir, the RS is remaining same, then how the absolute humidity changes? See, the absolute humidity is the ratio, amount of water per kilogram of dry air. So even if the amount of, if for example you take for constant absolute humidity, the RS value increases. When will the RS value increase? When we increase the temperature of the air. When we increase the temperature of air, the water holding capacity or the moisture holding capacity of the air increases. So its RS value decreases. So these kind of changes occur from the with respect to absolute humidity and relative humidity. So here the question asked is the thermal energy supplied per second during heating in kilowatt, thermal energy supplied. So actually what we have to use, we are using specific heat capacity. So here a mixture of air and water vapor is given. So actually we have to take in the proportionately, that is 0.02 kilogram of water per kilogram of dry air is given. So we have to take 0.02 into 1.88 plus 0.98. It is not 0.98, it is 1. 1 into 1.005. But here, when we go through the options given, the values are differing very much. 18, 36, 101, 166. So we can approximately take the value as 1 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. Okay. So for basically what is given? So the specific capacity means what? The unit is in kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. So the specific heat capacity means for a substance, for taking unit mass, that is 1 kilogram, to rise the temperature by 1 degree Kelvin, we need a amount of heat or amount of energy as 1.8. For example, the specific capacity of dry air is given as 1.65 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. That means if we take 1 kilogram of air, to increase the temperature of 1 kilogram of air by 1 degree Kelvin, we need 1.005 kilojoule. So similarly, in the case of water vapor, for increasing the temperature of 1 kilogram of water vapor by 1 degree Kelvin, we need 1.88 kilojoule. So here the question asked is the thermal energy supplied per second during heating. While heating, how much energy supplied? It is in kilowatt, that's kilojoules per second. So here the amount of air is given. Amount of air is 1 kilogram per second. So for in unit time, the unit kilogram of air is coming. To increase the temperature of that amount of air, how much energy is required? So here the temperature increases from 30 degrees Celsius to 65 degrees Celsius. That is, the temperature difference is 35. To rise the temperature by 35 degrees Celsius. So what is the approximate value? It is 1 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. That means 1 kilogram of air, to increase the temperature of 1 kilogram of air and water vapor mixture by 1 degree Kelvin requires 1 kilojoule. For here, we have to increase the temperature by 35 degrees Celsius or 35 degree Kelvin. As I already said, the temperature difference here taking is 65 and 30. Even if we convert to Kelvin, the temperature difference will be 35. Here 35 degrees Celsius or 35 Kelvin. So for 1 degree Kelvin, 1 kilogram require 1 kilojoule. So 35 require 35. But it is an approximate value. Actual value what we get is by substituting 0.02 into 1.88 plus 1 into 1.005. Based on that, we get 36.5. But it consumes our time. So since we look into the options, we can see that there is much difference between the values given in the options. So even if you get 35, we can approximately tell, or we can correctly tell, that 36.5 is the right answer. So always before trying to solve a numerical, always go through the options. So by going through the options, we will get sometimes if the options are given 36.5, 35.8, or a similar kind of thing, there is not much difference in number, then you have to substitute the correct value. Correct value, you have to use the value. But since it is using much more time, we can approximate so that we can save time. That time can be used for other numerical solving. Okay. Okay. It is another question. The initial moisture content of a food on wet basis is 50.76. Its moisture content on dry basis is, I think the question is asked in XC or XL stream. So the equation is by converting moisture content from wet basis to dry basis is moisture content wet basis by 1 minus moisture content wet basis. That is 50.76 by 1 minus 0.5076 by 1 minus 0.5076. Here the value is 103.1. Normally, if the concept is not clear, the student get the answer as 103.1%. So he doubts himself. The percentage value, how the percentage value will get greater than 100? So something I have done mistake. He will again do it, he will again. So a lot of time is wasted. So keep in mind, the dry basis moisture content value may come the value greater than 100%. But the wet basis, in the wet basis cases, the maximum value will be 100%. Okay. Now, let us look into another problem. Ambient air at 30 degrees Celsius dry bulb temperature and 80% relative humidity was heated to a dry bulb temperature of 80 degrees Celsius in a heat exchanger by indirect heat. The amount of moisture gain during the process would be. So, by looking into the questions, what is given? Ambient air, 30 degrees of dry bulb temperature, 80% RH, was heated to a dry bulb temperature of 80 degrees Celsius in a heat exchanger by indirect heating. The amount of moisture gain. So here, the process is heating, that is sensible heating. The temperature is increased. Here, mass transfer doesn't occur. So here the amount of moisture gain, the asking the moisture amount, the gain of moisture asked is irrelevant, because here the what happens is the sensible heating. So if the case is in dry, the heat and mass transfer occurs, that is the moisture content, the water from the food evaporates to the air, but here it is simply heating the air. So in that case the amount of moisture gain is zero. So because the if the concept is not clear, the numerical may appear to be very complex. The concept is clear, it is simple, because it is heating, there will be no moisture gain, so the answer will be zero. So without wasting the time, we can go to the other numericals. Okay, so these are our different numericals that I just gone through the previous year questions, different varieties. So basically, for solving a numerical regarding drying, the what I mentioned earlier, the concepts regarding the moisture content value, the humidity ratio values should be clear. If it is clear, basic terminology is clear. What if it is mentioned specific capacity, what is specific capacity means, or if it is mentioned an oral heat transfer coefficient, what does oral heat transfer coefficient means? Okay, that portion is clear to the aspirants, then it will be easier to solve the numericals, not only regarding dry, regarding any other food processing and numericals. Okay, so always go through the basics. Basic concepts regarding should be clear, then you move to the complex level of problems. Because while going through the previous question paper, you may see some complex numericals regarding drying, but that is not always the case. In GATE exams, there are some rank making questions, there are some complex numericals, but that varies. Sometimes it comes from drying, sometimes it comes from freezing, sometimes it comes from other portions. So it is not mandatory to always it come from drying or always it come from a single area. So what your approach should be like, that you should go through the basic problems, you should be able to solve the basic numericals, then you go to the intermediate level, then you go to the complex level. Because what happens is, when the students get see the complex numericals, he hesitate, he may think, oh, I can't solve the GATE exam. It is not the case like that. Anybody with a strategic approach, with a dedicated approach, can crack the GATE exam. Okay, I hope the portions regarding drive, since it is a shorter session, and I expected a more interactive session, that's why I went through only this much numericals, and it is about 1 hour. So if there is